Up next, we have Kevin. So Kevin is a junior in the Ideas program. He's majoring in public health and data science. He also attended LeaderShape in 2018, and he learned about defining his vision and how collaboration is the center point of any project. He's grateful that he had the opportunity to practice these skills in a controlled environment, and he felt the practical experience alone was priceless. So let's give it up for Kevin.
Have you guys ever seen that scene in High School Musical where Sharpay does those voice exercises? Yeah, I always want to do that before I speak because I feel like it'll help, but I've never actually done it. Does anyone want to get up and stretch? I know you guys have all been sitting down for a while. You could do some arm moves. A little stand up? Nah, see what you do. Okay. Hi everyone, my name is Kevin Mittal. As Priyom said, I am a junior in the Ideas program. I grew up in northern New Jersey, about an hour outside of Manhattan, in the suburbs, I'm a huge hip-hop and alternative rock fan, and my favorite director is Chris Nolan, and I really like to hike. So that's a little bit about me. I was asked here today to talk about leadership. I didn't really know how to go about talking about that, but I thought I would share some stories, and the best place to start was at the beginning. So I went to high school at this place called North Academy. I spent a lot of afternoons in that courtyard. It was a great place to go. The high school was about 400 students. It was pretty small in northern Jersey. And in that high school, I did a lot of things. I played tennis. I was in the school newspaper. I worked on a tutoring program for a bit. But my biggest commitment was always this thing called mock trial. So mock trial was this club we had in school, and there were 10 main team members on two sides. So there was a prosecution and a defense. And that's supposed to say two lawyers, but two lawyers and three witnesses, so five people, two sides, 10 people total. And my senior year, I was sort of in charge of the entire operation. And this was a team, like sports teams, that had been pretty competitive in the past. So for the past 5 years, they'd won at counties. And this year, like my senior year, I was really amped up. I was a senior, super excited to be done with college. I was thinking, you know what, I'm not just going to win counties like these guys have done for the past 5 years. I'm going to win sectionals, win states, and maybe go to nationals. That was the goal. And I put a lot of pressure on myself, actually, from day one to get that done. There's a lot of stress from the team itself to keep being as successful as we've done in the past. And there's a lot of internal pressure from myself to really push the team farther than it had ever gone before. So my strategy for doing that was, because we'd already done it for a while, we sort of had a set methodology for how this stuff was supposed to go. So I'm like, okay, you know, the best solution to get everyone to do the best work possible, to really hit the goals, is just work, work, and work. So first off, I increased the number of hours we were practicing a week. I checked in with every single team member at every single meeting. I was like, yo, are you top for your work? I would circle around them when we were at practice and try to catch people on Netflix or playing games and stuff. It was pretty intensive. I did a lot of mock trial performances were a lot about pre-scripted stuff and a lot of improv. So I would help them go through the improv part and practice them, quiz them on the material and make sure they knew it. And I would also go over all their written stuff really intensely. So as you can imagine, there's a lot of work on me personally, just to stay on top of everybody and make sure that they were getting it done. But I was like, it's gonna be worth it in 4 months from now when we compete and we win. But we lost, first round. And it was really bad because our team hadn't lost at counties at all in the past 5 years. And the worst part was, it wasn't even anybody else on my entire team who messed up our efforts. It was entirely my fault. I had spent so much time throughout the entire fall semester, making sure everybody was always on top of their own work. I spent such a little bit of time on my own product, which, as the lead member of the team, I had the most to do. So it was pretty ridiculous. And I walked into it just super prepared and was very clear to the conversation during the competition. So as you can imagine, that's pretty crushing to go into that hope you're going to win nationals and then lose the qualifiers. But thankfully, the first round was the first round where it wasn't single elimination. So my team members covered for me incredibly the next round, and they won, and we kept winning. And then we won counties again, which was really nice. But I really couldn't even claim credit for that, because it was my own team who was on top of their own work and who was passionate about what they were doing that really got it together. And then we lost in sectionals like we had for the past 5 years. But at that point, you know, like I was a spring semester senior, so it's cool. Did I come a lesson? Yeah. So I guess my first point I want to go over is I learned that senior year of high school that you're never going to succeed if you put everybody else's work product above your own. So a leader must focus on doing their best first, whether that's spiritually, physically, emotionally, or like professionally. And then you can make sure everybody else is. But if your own work product is on top, then your team is doomed to fail from the start. You can trust me on that. So the next thing I want to talk about is my fraternity. This is a picture of our house and a tree that fell down last spring. It was a pretty giant tree. It doesn't really have any relevance. It was just a cool picture. But this is where I live this year. It's a great place. Our fraternity is pretty small. It's got like 35 members. It's called Psi Upsilon. It's definitely one of my favorite places to be on campus. So, but a fraternity is kind of like a rudderless ship. Like, when you have 35 guys in one location, they all sort of join the fraternity for different reasons. Some are there for the brotherhood, some are there for the parties, a few are there for the philanthropy, and things like that. And everybody sort of has their own vision of how they want the house to go. Like, the president wants the fraternity to go this way, the vice president another way, the social a very specific direction, and like the risk manager a very specific direction. So it's really hard to make all of these ideas and goals for a house into one cohesive unit. What we do as a fraternity mostly centers around event planning. So recruitment, philanthropy, social and brotherhood are things I sort of spend all my time around. And those have some really basic responsibilities, like you make sure everybody has to show up, you make sure the event's set up, the event is cleaned up, and any other stuff you have to do. Event, someone has to collect the money or host the event. So it's really easy to get fraternity brothers to sign on to a cause. Like, yo, let's do Relay for Life this year. Does everyone want to donate and show up and walk around the track? Yeah, everyone's super excited about it, but then one or two people show up. Or let's throw like a huge register this weekend. We can invite a ton of different groups, and then you only have like five or six brothers show up. A lot of the problems that we face as like a big organization like this is making sure everybody's on the same page and that everybody's showing up and contributing their own part to everything. And it's something that's really hard to enforce. So as you can sort of guess by the picture, the biggest struggle that we always run into is that like when an event happens, everybody sort of expects like the other person's gonna do it, or like, you know, that's the president's job, or like, that's the social's job, or that's the rush chair's job. That's the risk manager's job. It always gets chaotic and confused. And in those sorts of situations, nothing ever gets done. Because like when it comes down to the moment of doing the work, college students get lazy and they get busy. And they always have stuff they want to do otherwise. So I guess I can talk about an experience, not a time where I failed, but experience that most of you know about who were at Leadership, which is successful event planning. When it comes to leadership, it's really about effective delegation and accountability. So when we decided to throw this campus connector, I guess only half of you went to leadership, but we came up with this idea for a register at Leadership where we try to invite a bunch of different groups on campus together and try to create a much more inclusive atmosphere and inclusive community. So it was really easy to get everyone to sign up from day one. We talked about it on the last day of leadership. Everyone was like, yeah, Kevin, like, this is awesome. Let's do it. I'm interested. But because I'd already been at Lehigh for 2.5 years at this point, I knew the first steps we had to do was set down a date and set down a location. And we got those two things easy. But it's really from that initial planning date until the actual day of the event where most of the chaos comes in. Because you have to develop ways to hold people accountable. And that was really easy for me because I delegated delegated the most difficult task for registering, which was attendance, to a lot of different club presidents or a lot of different organizational leaders. So all I really had to do was just harass people and text them and text them and text them until they confirmed that it was all going to go through. And that's something that's really served me well in my fraternity too. Whether it's like just having a system to make sure that people show up on time for their responsibilities and fulfill their responsibilities, to throwing a party. It's really about finding ways to keep your team accountable. Where's the clicker? And then my last sort of sphere I want to talk about is my work experience. So there's two general umbrellas I want to talk about here. It's like professional work experience, like internships. and the other umbrella was, is being a track fellow. So as a track fellow, your responsibilities are pretty simple. You just meet with students, you go over their essays, and you try to find ways to help them improve them. Whether that comes from content or organization, language, style, or any of those categories. So it's a pretty basic job here. It involves a lot of one-on-one interaction. And the reason why my internships were relevant is because they all sort of fall under that same umbrella of what I was struggling with at the time. So this picture is meant to describe lack of motivation. So a big problem that happens when you're a track fellow is like sometimes students will come in and they're not really interested in your feedback. They don't really want to sit there for 15 minutes and work with you on it, or they don't come in with a fully prepared draft. And something that happened on my internships, specifically when I was on Mountaintop, is it's like a very self-directed program. So it's very self-driven. You have to decide from day one like what goals you're going to accomplish, and you have to really push yourself to reach those. And in that sort of situation, it's really difficult for all teams and everyone to find like the internal motivation necessary to succeed. And it was something like I found a Mountaintop and I didn't want to go to work, and I was just like, this is terrible. Which happens with any project. And it was something that happened when I was a track fellow. Students would come in and they would just not want to listen to anything I say and try to get out of there in 5 minutes. So I had no idea this ended up being the solution. But apparently, if you build stronger emotional relationships with your team or with people you're working with, it really creates a stronger motivational standpoint. So this wasn't something I realized until I had this remote internship with this company called Osmosis. It's like a study tool to help students succeed in med school. And it was remote, so I barely saw my boss. I barely saw the people who were directly in charge of it. We just had like very short 1 minute video conversations like every week. And I was really confused because for the first 2 minutes of those conversations, they would always ask me like, yo, what's up, Kevin? How's your life doing? How are your professional goals doing? Like, what's causing you sleep lately? And we'd almost be spending 25% of our work time, which is pretty significant considering you're billed by the hour, on just talking about ourselves and what we were struggling with. And something else that the CEO did was he had us, all the employees, like put together a list of personal goals so we could help keep each other accountable or help keep each other on track. And those sorts of moves, goal sharing, social time during the workday, and really listening to your team members and seeing what's going on in their personal lives, help build a much stronger relationship as a team and really incentivize people to work harder and to stay a part of the team when a different opportunity comes along. So, this was a lesson I learned when I was 20 years old, and now I'm 21, and I like think if I had just gone back to my child, like I could have spent 50% of our time like just being friends with those kids and having a great time. I would have not only had more fun, but we would not have lost that first round. So the lesson here was personal relationships with your team are essential for the most effective and satisfying experience. And I say effective because you're going to do better and you're going to succeed a lot more, and satisfying just because you're going to be happier too if you're friends with the people you're working with. And that's definitely something I think we should all strive towards. So those are my three lessons, and I have like a little bit of a future goals thing up here too. So something else I've also realized over the past 3 years, over these experiences I've gone over with you, is that if I just asked for help a little bit more when I was struggling or talked to people more about my problems, then I probably could have found these lessons a lot earlier. Like, I was Googling up my ideas and my themes for this presentation before it, and it turns out there's tons of literature on all of these lessons. guess something that I'm also going to try to work on it's a bit sort of a lesson for, is to always ask for help first when you're struggling, and see if people have gone through the same problem you have, because with 6 billion people on the planet, the chances are you're not the first one to do it. Thank you, everyone. That's it.